Hi, this is Annie Dance. I'm an investigative independent journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in North Carolina, Connecticut, and beyond. Really, the whole entire United States. If there is a police and policy issue, I am on it with my Cops in Congress newsletter. Please subscribe to AnnieDanceDeathSubstack.com if you haven't already and follow me on social media. You may have seen my past reporting from May 3rd. The governor of Connecticut, Ned Lamont, said, quote, a situation was impacting thousands on the East Coast from a Connecticut fire and highway closure on I-95 in Norwalk, Connecticut. You can read through my past reporting for more details. But the headline is that now, Tuesday, May 7th, 2024, 95 has been reopened as crews worked through the weekend to reopen the road. But how did we get here? Connecticut's law enforcement agencies were on high alert after a three-vehicle crash caused a massive fire impacting travel and life along the East Coast. Please watch my previous video you can find on that article for more information and more context. I also archived and recorded all three press conferences that officials gave. They are definitely worth a watch. Governor Lamont was asked to describe the economic impact that he wrote would impact the entire Eastern Seaboard. The governor shrugged and said, quote, thank God it's Friday. He also further disclosed that he declared a state of emergency to get federal funds. The Connecticut State Police Specialized Collision Analysis and Reconstruction Squad, known as CARS, was mobilized to investigate, the colonel said at the press conference. Colonel Logman was promoted to that position less than a month ago, but he has been a trooper for many years, according to reports. So police are investigating. Here's Senator Blumenthal at one of the press conferences. And he said at that press conference that federal money would pay for repairs. Major transportation hubs and critical infrastructure, such as bridges, are highlighted as possible terrorism targets by the Department of Homeland Security. So I have many questions as the investigation continues, more to come on that. But for now, let's listen to the latest press conference. And again, please look at my past reporting for more information. Some of those questions that I have is, when will Connecticut State Police release their report? Why doesn't the Connecticut Department of Transportation, ctroads.org, record and archive their footage? This is a screenshot from the website, ctroads.org, which states that the monitoring traffic is used for, the cameras are used for live monitoring of traffic and do not record. No traffic camera recordings are available for disclosure, public records, because no recordings exist. Interesting. How much are taxpayers paying for cameras that don't record? Was this an accident? Was it on purpose? Was it terrorism? Again, bridges are critical infrastructure. What are lawmakers, officials, and law enforcement doing to prevent another, quote, situation like this? The governor is calling it a, quote, situation. He's not calling it an accident. So let's look at his subsequent press releases indicating that the roads would reopen. And it's very interesting to me that the promptness of the road reopening and the demolition of this bridge happened so quickly, because what could, if that can happen at that, in that time frame, then it leads to many more questions as why can't something like that happen in other situations? Why do transportation projects typically take years? If they could do the demolition that quickly, it raises other questions in my mind. So again, what would happen if multiple, quote, situations occurred at the same time, impacting travel on more roads? This is amazing. It impacted thousands of people, if not tens of thousands of people. So the latest press release that I read indicated that there's $3 million in federal money coming for repairs. So those repairs, under what Congress allocates as part of federal highway disasters, there's a very interesting phrase. Let me see if I can find it again. It says emergency relief program helping communities hurt by natural disasters and quote catastrophic events is a priority, along with providing federal funding to repair damaged roads and bridges. So there was another phrase that stood out to me, catastrophic failures from an external cause. So a 22-year-old driver created this. He has not been charged with a crime, but his actions caused a, quote, catastrophic failure from an external cause. That's according to the federal government. So let's take a listen at what officials are saying at the latest press conference that was held in Norwalk yesterday morning. I will note, I don't know why they had decided to hold this right in front of the roadway, but it's incredibly noisy and there's no automatic closed captioning. Typically, that's associated with Facebook videos, so I apologize in advance if you can't hear it, but I've turned up all my volumes on my end, and we'll try to make do with what government is telling us.
It's long line. We love having you here, but we hope you don't come back for a while. But this is a remarkable recovery. And as you can see behind me, this is a real team effort. A lot of people have helped us to get this done so quickly. We're absolutely amazed that this was prepared. They originally said Monday morning for rush hour, which went on this morning, but it happened 10 o'clock yesterday morning. They opened this up, and it was just remarkable that this was done in such a quick turnaround. There are a lot of people at that, but the one person that I want to bring forward to thank, because it was his team, his response, his call to me in the morning that really got this going, and that's Governor Lamont. Governor Lamont. And Harry, I called you in the morning. I'm just glad to get all the work. We came down here on Friday to meet you guys, and it was hell getting here. You remember that? The hours and hours of delays, into the traffic here on 95, moving fast in both directions. You know, too often in government, you have politicians who overpromise and under-deliver. Not to put the same behind me here. These guys over-delivered. In less than 80 hours, they took a bridge that was destroyed, fire burning up, fire department right here, got down there, got the fire out. Then we had the state police come in. Do the criminal investigation, the investigation seal we had to do, deep energy and environment had to come, make sure nothing, no poisons were flowing into the water. And then we had contractors from Yonkers and beyond that came in here, had to move in the heavy equipment, had to move in the heavy equipment despite incredible traffic. You know, this was 3 days ago. And look, they got that bridge down on a timely basis. They got northbound going. Then they got southbound going. They had southbound going on Sunday, time for church. This is an amazing work of art. You know, too often people sell, government short. This is a team that I'm so proud of getting the job done. In particular, Garrett, you believe. Now, Garrett's in charge of about $1 billion extra a year for infrastructure, that's fixing our roads and bridges. It just shows you the type of work they have done. I just hope to God this never happens again. And God, if it does happen again, you got one of those 100-year-old bridges, not one of the brand new bridges that the one that was just taken out. But seriously, hats off to the people that got this done on a timely basis, keeping us safe, rush hours working. And wouldn't be able to do it with our friends in Washington, D.C., Senator Dick Blumenthal. Thank you, Governor.
If Washington is looking for a model, come to Connecticut, a model of teamwork, a symphony of teamwork that went to work on this project over the weekend. Guys behind me here have been without sleep for quite a while. And as good as they look, those guys in the yellow vest have given time, effort, energy over this weekend in this kind of symphony of teamwork to make it possible for the bridge to come down, the remains to be removed, the traffic to be resumed. Now, the next chapter. And that reconstruction of this bridge, we want to make sure it's done at the expense of the federal government. The federal government ought to bear a major part of the burden here, and we're going to demand that the Federal Highway Relief Fund fund this project so that Connecticut taxpayers don't bear the burden. The Federal Highway Administration has the fund. It is exactly for this purpose. And we as a delegation sent a letter on Friday to the Secretary of Transportation demanding that it be forthcoming and fund its full share of the cost of reconstructing the bridge. It may be $20 million, it may be a bit more. Whatever it costs, the federal government ought to bear the major, if not all, the major part of that cost, so Connecticut taxpayers are spared a burden. And we're going to make sure that businesses that are affected have whatever relief that the federal government can provide as well. There's going to be disruption to traffic. No question that access to some of these businesses is going to be constrained over the year that it takes to reconstruct that bridge. And our hope is that the disruption will be minimal and that whatever federal relief will be provided by the government. Finally, let me just say, you know, these guys spent a lot of time. They were away from their family. They devoted that time cheerfully, and they should be spared the risk of traffic, delays, and people ought to be respectful when the contractors or DOT folks are at work on the roads. Slow down, move over. Make sure that safety is on your mind when you see people at work on the highway. Slow down, move over, save lives. Respect the work that these guys are doing because they're devoting their time. They're putting a lot of effort in. They shouldn't have to risk their lives. If you see them at work, you can avoid the kinds of crashes that occur literally every day in America because people speed by these sites without respect for the guys who are on the job doing the work. We're all familiar with the kinds of complaints that we have out there. People love to complain about state government and federal government, but this is an example. It's a success story that people ought to take away and say, these guys deserve respect. They deserve thanks. They're the ones who made it happen. And leading them was the commissioner of our State Department of Transportation, Garrett Ugolino, right in his seat.
Thank you, sir. I think you heard a lot of people talk about teamwork. That really is what this was from our fellow state agencies, from our local partners, even communicating with our peer state DOTs from Maryland all the way up to Massachusetts to coordinate messaging. The Federal Highway Administrator is I will say that normally the sound behind us gets a lot of complaints. Highway noise, I think today's probably the only day we're not going to get complaints about highway noise, so I'm going to relish that. But now we also move into the next phase, which is the reconstruction and rebuilding of the Pierpont Avenue Bridge. So our team has been working over the weekend to begin to finalize what's our preliminary design for rebuilding. So while our highway operations maintenance team is out here in the response, construction engineers were out here for the demolition. The Yonkers crews came down from other job sites nearby. Big shout out to Yonkers. They're hiding behind the press right now, but they're here on site and they give them a lot of credit. Their crews are the ones doing the demolition. And then our engineers designing the future bridge were working all of the weekends to make sure that we don't let a minute lapse. So I just want to thank everyone for the cooperation that made this possible. Thank you.
as you can see, there's no federal state with the partnership, and that's the way things work. A person who has always been here for Norwalk and for the state, trying to do everything that he can to make sure that Norwalk's quality of life is second to none. And that is Senator Bob Duff, the majority leader of the Connecticut Senate.
Thank you, Mayor. Good morning, everybody. We knew when we heard about this accident on Thursday that it was going to be a traffic nightmare for the people in the city of Norwalk, including all over the place. And so first and foremost, I want to thank the people of Norwalk for their patience and understanding over the last few days while there was gridlock really throughout the city and people were trying to navigate their way through. Many people here in the city stayed off the roads wisely so that others could get back, could get off the highway, on the highway safely and not add to the extra traffic that was out there. So I appreciate all the patience of the people of the city of Norwalk. Secondly, of course, we do have to thank our DOT workers and Yonkers, our state police, our local police, and our local firefighters. Everybody worked very well together, and I appreciate our local police who used a lot of technology to monitor traffic flow to ensure that they were doing everything possible to keep cars moving to the best extent possible. Lastly, I'll just say that yesterday was National Fallen Firefighter Day, and that honors firefighters who lost their lives in the line. Thankfully, nobody got injured or passed away through this accident. But watching those flames from that fire from a truck that lost thousands and thousands of gallons of fuel, and the firefighters who bravely fought that fire to bring it under control, merits recognition for what they have done to be able to do that in a safe manner and in a manner that kept everybody else harm free. So I appreciate all of our first responders for what they did to keep the area safe and keep traffic moving and to keep the city safe. Lastly, I wanted to thank Commissioner Ugolito especially for setting up that webcam that literally everybody watched over the weekend. And I said earlier that it was like watching the Truman Show, because if you remember that movie, like an entire city was watching Jim Carrey, and that was pretty much how it was. We had people all over the place just telling me that they were addicted to that webcam watching the progress train made. And people were so happy to see that open up earlier than expected. So Garrett, thank you, Commissioner, for being so transparent in the process. And then lastly, of course, the mayor and his team and the governor, Lamont, and his team. This cannot be done without good leadership from the executive branch, whether it's local or state. So thank you, governor. Thank you, mayor, for your work on this as well, and making sure that this got done and opens on time, actually early, and the people of Norwalk are changed. So thank you very, very much. All right. And I'm speaking also on behalf of my colleagues in the legislature. We have Representative Dominique Johnson here and Representative Kadeem Roberts, and we've all been communicating together about this, and I appreciate all that. So we're going to open up the questions, but again, I want to thank everybody behind me. Everybody was on the scene within a couple of minutes and taking control, making sure that this is going to be handled as quickly as possible. They do that because they're professional. They know what they had to do, and they did it. So now we'll open it up to questions.
Our goal is to have a design for the next couple of weeks. And you have people with a ribbon cutting within the next year.
So
Larry Bridge Construction doesn't work here. We'd have to have space to build, scan on site, and roll it in. We don't have space here.
Do you have an estimate of what the cleanup cost, the work to take the bridge down?
No, we think it's probably around $2 million or so, maybe up to $3 million. But until we get all the bills in from all the different parties, we don't know. We think the total cost will be upwards of around $20 million cleanup and rebuild.
Okay.
in the past couple of days, we've had the Norwalk Fire Department, the Norwalk Police Department, keeping track of all the expenses, which will be overtime and other kinds of things, so that we can get reimbursement. So again, it won't fall on the backs of the local taxpayers. So it really was the ability to mobilize forces really quickly. You know, we had a great partner with Yonkers, which is working on a project right nearby. Our chief engineer and our construction administrator immediately mobilized to contact them. They were able to bring some equipment that was nearby to start the initial demolition. The real heavy, the shears that came to do the final piece of demolition, that had to come from New York. Yonkers was able to mobilize that. State police helped with police escorts to get those equipment up here. But really, it was just the proximity, having people nearby that we could mobilize quickly and efficiently to start that demolition.
So hindsight is 2020, and I'm sure Thursday was really stressful for the truck driver. Without casting any aspersions on the truck driver, have you been able to determine why he stopped where he stopped rather than pulling up 50 feet?
I don't know. That's a question for state police, but you know, I've thought about that too myself. But then people have reminded me, if I was driving a truck with 8,500 gallons of gasoline, when I looked in my rear window and it was on fire, I'd probably pull over wherever and get out of that truck as quickly as possible.
And can I ask someone from Norwalk Fire, as you do your after action, do you have, looking back now, did you have everything you needed, or is there something on your wish list now? God forbid this could happen again.
Good morning. So, resources.
Yeah. Anything on your wish list now going forward?
No. I mean, I think we were fortunate to be able to call on the regional resources that we did, including the surrounding departments, our partners at the fire and safety team at King Industries. We were able to get enough firefighting resources on the scene, enough foam on the scene quickly to be able to take care of the incident and in the manner that we did. My hat is off to all of the agencies who came in to assist the Norwalk Fire Department in mitigating this incident. But particularly to the first fire officers and the first firefighters who arrived on scene. They made very good tactical decisions early on, which allowed the incident to end with good results. And given the scope of this incident and the magnitude of it, that's really nothing short of remarkable. So to answer your question, we did have the resources that we needed because of the mutual aid partnerships that we already had in place.
What were one or two of the key tactical decisions you just referenced?
The key tactical decisions would have been to start cooling the truck with the water streams that they had initially, start cooling the bridge to prevent it from collapsing, and then being able to get a foam engine on scene quickly. And it was really the foam engine and the line inside the bridge that were able to extinguish the fire. Well, certainly it's a challenge. It's not a type of incident that happens very often, but it is something that we train for. We do have procedures in place for this type of incident on the highway, and so the first responders really fell back on their training. They knew what resources to call for, and they knew how to approach it effectively and safely.
Do you anticipate, this is for Department of
Transportation. We anticipate cleaning out the fire with the defendants. But equally important, containing the spill. The river is nearby. There could have been a major environmental disaster without the experts who work with the fire department. They no longer devoted to it. So often we focus on the disaster and the flames and the burning. But it's exemplary here what didn't happen, which is a major contaminant of the river and the river.
Do you anticipate any lane closures or detours during the construction process, particularly on this portion of I-95?
Oh, yeah, definitely we'll have to do a few, like, things places at various points throughout the year period. But it won't, definitely won't be as disruptive as what we just encountered. Looking at lane closure, maybe a center lane or the left lane closure near the pier, or the right lane closure near the abutments. But that's normal during the construction process, but it won't be permanent.
Do you have a timeline for taking down the pier? It's really the only thing we can see left of the bridge.
No, we don't. So that's going to be a part of the design process that we're undergoing right now. How do we incorporate a new pier structure that we can design? And we'll figure out who staged that during the design process.
Thank you, everybody.
Yeah.
There you have it, word for word, what they said at the press conference. In a subsequent Facebook post, the governor said, quote, the quick support the federal government is appreciated and will help us accelerate the rehabilitation of I-95 in Norwalk. Here's a photo of the burned tractor trailer. The Federal Highway Administration quick release funds were, again, part of the Biden-Harris administration's focused immediately on helping Governor Lamont quickly restore travel, said U.S. Department of Transportation Secretary Pete Buttigieg. These emergency funds helped DOT safely repair and reopen the road in less than 80 hours and can now help with costs associated with rebuilding the bridge. Very interestingly, officials have said the road opened Sunday morning. However, the federal government says CTDOT reopened I-95 Sunday evening. The timelines on these sort of events are very important because it gives not only an archived history of the accurate reporting of the facts, but be honest, why would you say it's open Sunday morning? Obviously, that sounds better to a politician. Finally, I want to highlight some of the other reporting about this incident. NBC Connecticut shared this photo on their website of just the absolutely horrendous fire caused by, again, a 22-year-old driver. I'll be sharing more information on that separately. But first, I want to get an accurate picture of reporting of what officials are saying about this incident. So NBC Connecticut also reported that police sources are telling them that it may have been a reckless driver, and police are investigating that. They have more information about reckless driving in the state, but of course it's really a national issue. It's not, certainly not only in Connecticut, it's everywhere. So again, they did really, if you look at it from not knowing all these details and relationships between the agencies, I have an intricate knowledge of that from being on a local commission and a statewide transportation committee for several years. You can learn more about that from viewing my previous reporting and watching my previous videos. But again, I'll highlight that state public safety sources have told NBC Connecticut that reckless driving by the operator of the car appears to be involved in the collision, which, quote, paralyzed one of our country's largest traffic corridors. In their Reckless on Road series, they talked about different transportation issues. And what's really interesting, if you look at it from sort of a psychological perspective too, is they said that reckless driving gets worse as the work week goes on, and the crash on Norwalk took place on Thursday. We don't exactly know why we see this increase, but it's very clear in the data that the week goes on, we see the number of aggressive driving crashes increasingly dramatic over time, the Transportation Safety Institute Executive Director Eric Jackson said. So they said the question now is what, if any, of this crash may have been on camera. As I mentioned before, that is unclear currently. One state law enforcement source told them they couldn't confirm any further details, as I officially got word from state police in a separate email when I followed up with them very early on in the investigation. They simply said, it's an active investigation. We understand you have questions, but it's an active investigation, and they wouldn't go further. However, NBC Connecticut reports from a previous conversation in March with a trooper, Michael Dean, who said, quote, dash cams have been a game changer. They have allowed me to see the scene as it unfolds and know exactly what happened. And this can trickle down all the way to simple speeding violation or failure to maintain lane. If you're able to send those videos into us, then we can pull a license plate. It is possible we can see who's behind the wheel. Then we can follow up at their house and get more information that the public helping us out can only improve road safety, according to that trooper. So, my understanding is that the police are still investigating. They have not charged the driver with any crimes. There were no serious injuries. I believe there were minor injuries of the truck driver whose truck caught on fire, and more to come on this developing story. Please stay tuned and subscribe and share. Thank you so much. I really appreciate your support. I'll see you next time.